There are places I remember all my life. Though some have changed, some forever, not for better. Some have gone, and some remain. All these places have...
Michael from Red Chair Diaries here in Nova Scotia, Canada. I want to talk about Black Hills by Dan Simmons, copyright 2010. Bought this in February. Print's pretty big. They wasted a lot of paper, and then here's the electronic version that I was concurrently reading that I borrowed from the city library. So the color doesn't quite show up there, but different covers. I guess this is an American version here. Oh, fuck, pop-ups for quick time. Get out of here. Now, taking me an age to read this. And when I got this book, I told you people that it was kind of bizarre. Pahasapa, which is Sioux, I guess, for Black Hills, is an American Indian shaman who believes that as a young boy at the Battle of Little Bighorn, he took the ghost of the dying General Custer into his body. 60 years later, while working as a dynamiter on Mount Rushmore, Pahasapa plots to blow up the monument. Meanwhile, Custer finds himself trapped in a strange, dark place and begins to write sensuous, heartbreaking missives to his beloved wife. Thus begins an intricate visionary story that sweeps across some of the most tumultuous and violent periods of American history, from the Old West to the Dust Bowl of the 1930s and into our own time and beyond. Now, I like Dan Simmons' books. I've read many. Olympus, Ilium, Summer of Night, Children of the Night, Carrion Comfort, one of the best vampire novels ever. You should go get that one, Carrion Comfort. I have others of his I haven't gotten to yet. I've got Drood, which is about the Charles Dickens unfinished book and the characters in it. And two science fiction novels of his I've had for years and I haven't gotten around to. I can't remember the name of them. Anyway. Hyperion and Hyperion Rising, something like that. But this one here, it was a strain for me. It's like he put all of his knowledge of the North American Indian, the natives, the building of Mount Rushmore, the monument to presidents, and the Chicago World's Fair in 1883, I think it was, or 1886, something like that. And the geology of the Great Plains, his belief in an afterlife, I think, and so on. And it just is such a hodgepodge. It's not scary like a lot of his other books, and I do find it drags. Now, it doesn't mean that it's not interesting. It's very interesting, but to me, as the reader, I think it's unfocused. But you may have a different opinion. If you've ever read Moby Dick, you understand that, you know, there's that narrative of Captain Ahab and the great white whale and all of that, but there's also like an encyclopedic knowledge of ocean life, particularly the life cycle of whales, is part of that novel. So you end up going on these tangents. I mean, relevant tangents, but tangents nonetheless. And that's what this is like, because we end up with all of the little bighorn history. We end up with crazy horses in here, and he's really crazy. We end up with the World's Fair, the invention of the Ferris wheel by Mr. Ferris, descriptions of the turbine engines that are powering that, all manner of detail about how to create large sculptures out of mountains, and with dynamite, pneumatic drills, bosun's chairs, all of this stuff. Then we have a large part of this about the Dust Bowl in the 1930s.
And I forgot to tell you that there's major, major section on the construction of the Brooklyn Bridge. Who knew? And why is it in this book?
The destruction of the buffalo is in here, an explanation for that. We get his character marries, she's basically non-native. I think she had 1/4 or 1/8 or whatever. And so we end up with history for her and future history for her. We end up with a large history for the almost crazy designer and sculptor of Mount Rushmore, and all the and the plans that he had for even more additions to the wall, an archive in the mountains of all the Americans' most important historical documents, his so-called Hall of Records that he wanted to get money for. So you get a lot of that. You learn all about explosives. I'm missing things. Oh, we've even got tangents about from his newspaper reading about Adolf Hitler coming to power, and then he ties in a history or future history of some Jewish families that are going to be married into his family. It just gets very, very convoluted, I think. But each chapter is still interesting. And one of the revelations about Black Hills, if what Mr. Simmons his research is more accurate than maybe popular culture would have had me believe, the discussion about Little Bighorn and General George Armstrong Custer is very interesting. That he didn't seem to be a racist when it came to the Indians. He was just in the army sort of thing. And so you get that juxtaposed with all of the history of the natives, and you know their sweat lodge sort of activities, and their vision quests, and which tribes took scalps, which tribes were just murderous tribes as opposed to tribes protecting themselves. So there was, you know, a discussion of warrior tribes. And the thing about Custer in this is, you know, he dies the first few pages. I mean, that's the foundation of the book, so it's not a spoiler. But what there's a rehabilitation of his image, because there are reams and reams of his letters that I guess his spirit seems to be trapped in this boy's head who
you know, throughout the book goes from his, I guess, age 10 or 11 to his 90s. So you get first-person narrative by the late George Custer, basically writing letters to his widow, Libby. And, oh my goodness, I did. Custer was so into cunnilingus, and his wife was so into fellatio. I mean, they were just having sex left, right, and center. I mean, like, the tone of these letters were not what we come to expect from popular entertainment about Westerns, you know, and the military. And they're interesting, but they're actually, in some ways, even vulgar, you know. So I found it not off-putting, because I'm certainly not put off about sex or eroticism or anything like that. It's just that the tone was so interesting, you know, it was so different. So he's kind of like in this netherworld. So you take that with all of the historical elements, and FDR's in here, and you know, different senators and all of this, you know, about the construction of Mount Rushmore, and you get all of that in this book. Like, that's a big order, and digesting it does take a lot out of you. So if you're interested in Western novels, American history, Native American history, there's a lot in here to enjoy. Lots of nuggets to nibble on. Yes, Bobbin? You okay? I think my dog's sick again, my Bobbin. She doesn't seem to feel too good. But it does require a lot of attention. You know, it's not a quick read in what I would assume would be like a Dan Brown way. I've only read that terrible book, The Da Vinci Code. But it does move along, doesn't it? And the Stephen King book moves along. Stephen King's a big, big admirer of Dan Simmons. But I just think it's too much, you know, like I just think he threw too much in there. But I would tell you, this would make a wonderful miniseries where they could actually keep going back and forth in time, because it's flashbacks and flash forwards and current history. I mean, if we take 1930s as the current milieu of the book, when the Mount Rushmore is being carved, the 20s and 30s, I guess, as the present, and then Little Bighorn as the past, and all of that. It would make a wonderful, wonderful series, because then you've got the time to explore. You know, like the way Game of Thrones is wonderful. You've got time to digest these activities. But to throw them all into this book like this, there's at least 6 books in here. I think is a bit difficult. Anyway, I got through it. I'm very proud of myself, and I do recommend it, but I recommend it with reservations. And that is not a pun about the Indians. So, it's Michael from Red Chair Diaries, debuting my new red robe I got today, which looks quite nice against my chair. And I got it at the Sears Bargain Center, the outlet center in Halifax, and they had Seniors Day. If you're 55 and older, you got 15% off on all of the already reduced clothes. So if I use my Sears card, so isn't that lovely? So it was lovely, because now I needed a new heavier robe for the fall and winter that doesn't have sleeves that get into everything like my other terry cloth robe that you've seen before. Okay, it's Michael from Red Shirt Diaries with a book commentary. I'll see you around the tube.